it now sponsors and runs its own conventions. And it started really as far back as 1991 when I was asked by member and store owner John Coster of Federation Comics to work on a convention. As things turned out, many of the people involved didn't really live up to their end of things, and the Star Trek group we were involved with left being the organizational part of the convention, and it was down to John and me, and then John, unfortunately, with all his other business ventures, such as his store and stuff, was unable to deliver a lot of what he had hoped to do. So we ended up reducing it to a one-day event. It was called United Fan Con. It took place on May 23rd of 1992 at Boston University with special guests Robin Curtis, John Levine, and Sophie Aldred.
Hey, all you sci-fi fans, here's something you might be interested in knowing more about. Coming up later this month, the United Fandom Association will be presenting a science fiction convention featuring Doctor Who's Ace and Sergeant Benton, as well as Star Trek's Savick. If you'd like more information about this multimedia celebration called United FanCon, at 617-325-6461.
Now, there's a surprise. My name is John Levine, and I've been invited to do this very special commercial for a convention which is coming up in 1992. I've got to tell you about it because I'm very excited at being invited. It's the United Fan Con, and that's being held here. It's a multimedia celebration. The most important facts for you to know is that it is being held on a two-day thing, the 23rd and 24th of May 1992. And as you've seen already on the program, we're going to be doing it at the Boston University at the George Sherman Union Building. But the most important thing is the people who are attending for your enjoyment. Sophie Aldred, she is so popular as Ace in the modern Doctor Who, with Sylvester McCoy, of course, playing the Doctor, and myself, who a little older and a little longer ago did the show, but my name is John Levine, I played Sergeant Benton, and to tie it all together to give you a whole spectrum of all of Doctor Who that we've appeared in, we have also Mr. John Peel, who is an historian and knows just about everything there is to know about Doctor Who.
And welcome to United Fan Con. Over a year in the works, a lot of changes. Well, we actually did it, I think.
Yes, question. Yeah.
Another question for Sophie?
Yes.
Have you had any trouble being looking younger than you are? Have had any trouble with as far as professional organizations, acting organizations, and typecasts?
Right, yes. The question is, do I have problems with looking a lot younger than I am? I mean, I suppose at my age, no, it's not a problem. It's rather nice, actually.
I thought that would be the only show we did, and had seriously reconsidered doing anything again until I met Joe Kendall and Tim LeBron of K&L Productions, who recruited me into working for them to set up a Boston-based convention. And before you know it, in Doctor Who's 30th anniversary year, 1993, UNIT was responsible for getting John Pertwee to come to Boston. I had negotiated their contracts for him and for Mark Goddard and arranged for the location, which was the Copy Plaza Hotel.
Come on, for Christ's sake, say something, otherwise I'll go.
Are you going to have a second volume in your autobiography?
Have a what? Another one?
Yeah, I love the first one.
Good.
Well, some great anecdotes.
The reason I wrote the autobiography was that I was doing a series called Wurzel Gummidge, which you're not allowed to see. You're not allowed to see it because the powers that be are convinced that Americans can't understand English. So they say, no, we're not going to have Wurzel Gummidge because nobody will understand it. The fact that I've played it to hundreds and hundreds of Americans, all who've understood every single word and loved it and says, why don't we get it? That's the way it goes. So I was doing it for a new producer when Southern Television lost their franchise. And I was working for Southern, and then Southern lost their franchise to operate, so I had no producer. And so a new producer who had directed and produced a series called, which you've seen in America on PBS, called Peter Bowles, Irish. Oh, yes, the Irish...
RM?
RM,
yeah.
That's it.
And later on in that year, of Doctor Who's 30th anniversary in 1993, in November, we sponsored two Doctor Who guests at WishCon 3. We had John Levine return, and we got Wendy Padbury in her first ever convention appearance. This is an opportunity for us to do some special alternative programming. We did the Joan Anthony Blake show, kind of a variety show cabaret idea. We also had videos of Invasion, which both of the guests sat in on and gave commentary, and fans really enjoyed it.
Paul Scarlett Production, U.S. Branch Unit, and the Night Joy Guardian proudly present the Joan Anthony Blake Show, starring Joan Anthony Blake!
Welcome to the John Anthony Blake Show. It'd be nice if I really had my own show, wouldn't it?
I don't think that's going to. Well, Debbie Watley was always the butt of practical jokes for Patrick Troughton and Frazer Hines. Did you inherit that mantle when you became Zoe?
Yes.
I never gave up, did I? Never stopped.
What was the worst one they ever played on?
Take some thinking. There were so many.
There were so many that you forget because they happened all the time. It just became like, it didn't matter, you know, you knew something was going to happen. I think the worst one was when I'd had quite a late night. I was young then, quite a late night. And I remember going to rehearsals. We used to rehearse in a church hall.
Yeah. Old Oak Road.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just off Ladbroke Road.
Yes. Yeah.
And I was wearing a kilt, very short, because you were allowed then.
Yes, pretty skirt.
It's very, very short. And it was a proper kilt with a pin and a buckle, a couple of buckles here. But I'd had a very late night, and I can't remember whose story it was, who was directing. Ducky Canfield or somebody, or one of them, Michael Fox, or one of them. And we'd done a scene, and somebody else was having a go at practicing. And so I decided to sit down on the chair at the side of the rehearsal room. And Pat sat this side. And because I'd had a late night, I was nodding off like this. And all of a sudden, I was nudged like that. And Fraser went, quick, get up, wait, let's ask.
Oh,
went
no.
Like that.
Oh, no.
And my skirt. And so I ran. I was so embarrassed. I sort of did this. I ran out of the room, and it was a church hall we were rehearsing. All I did was I said, "Morning."
In 1994, U.N.I.T took over the primary organization of the convention, WishCon, and we brought Nicola Bryant, and as it would turn out to be Armin Shimerman, Robert O'Reilly, and Mark Goddard.
And we were rehearsing this sequence where, as the Doctor, he's going through this sort of suddenly cowardly period, and he's cowering behind Perry, and he's holding onto the back of Perry, saying, "Don't shoot, don't shoot." And he sinks his teeth into my bum. You know, this is like day two or three of rehearsal. And I'm thinking, I know exactly what Peter was talking about. This is serious shit, you know? Oh, great, 3 years of this, I can't wait.
And a spotlight comes up on me, and the spotlight comes up, and all of a sudden, from out of the darkness goes, psst, bing, and I look down, and there was a paper clip. And I went, oh, it's gonna be a long afternoon. So immediately I went into my Gowron thing and I just went, "You! I saw you!" Now, when you're on stage, you can't see anything, you know? Especially when a spotlight is on you, but, you know, I had to pretend, "You! I saw you! And if it happens again, you will have to go out on the street. Do you understand?" And from the distance I heard, "Yes!"
Was it harder to play Romana or
a princess.
Princess.
What was that? What was the name of that princess? I forget. Oh, thank you. Yes, Princess Strella. Yes. Which was the hardest? Well, yeah. The funny thing was, it was hardest playing the android because I enjoyed that particular story because I got to play three parts. I mean, for those of you all know what to. Yeah. So I was playing three roles there, and I liked playing the princess, you know, because of all the crown and the lovely costumes and everything. It's just like dressing up.
There's Mary. Okay, all right, here we go. Let's do this little thing with Mary. So, I did this the first day, you weren't here. I was reading through the WishCon program, and it has all the these beautiful bios, you know, what we've done and everything, and so I read through Mary's, and Mary's was like, Mary Tam was born in Dewbury, England, raised in Bradford, early 50s. She auditioned for and was accepted by the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts. Her acting career began in 71, the Birmingham Repertory Company, BBC, early film credits, Odessa Fire, Likely Lads, Doctor Who, da-da-da, and it goes on, right? Then I turned to mine. Garrett Wang, pronounced Wong, was born in Riverside, California, although he spent his formative years in Indiana, Bermuda, and Memphis. While still in the first grade, he had his first acting experience in a school play called The Animals Have a Picnic. In the words of Mary Tam, what's that? What was that? I don't know.
Yes.
Theory that a lot of the companions, you know, especially the women, turn out to be, you know, these just screaming people, you know, that, you know.
The women are screaming people.
Well,
you'd scream if you had a Dalek pursuing you down a corridor. I've never understood why screaming is such a terrible thing to do. I mean, you know, it doesn't matter whether you're male, female, old, young, stupid, clever. If something like that pursues you and wants to kill you, you scream.
But the, you know, if you look at the first companion of Tom Baker, who was also with the previous one.
Is that Louise?
I believe so.
Oh, Sarah Jane, yeah, sorry.
I mean, she started out a very strong character,
mm-hmm.
I mean, strong emotionally. And as her time ran on, she started getting into the helpless companion.
That's the effect it has on you. The longer you stay in the series, the more you start screaming.
Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him. Oh, thou bleeding piece of earth. Thou art the ruins of the noblest man that ever lived in the tide of times. Woe to the hand that shed this costly blood. Pass the butter.
There was this scene where I go, so, you know, Captain wants to see you, you know, I'm trying to talk her into it. I said, will you come? And I in rehearsal, I actually said, Captain wants to see you. Did you come? I didn't know exactly what was really going on in my mind, but let's see. Zach leering at Lita.
If I played Doctor Who, I should need a nice young man.
Would he have to be a model, or could be a convention promoter?
What about a combination? Well, yes.
Would you want them to scream or just say, Doctor?
Why not? If we all have to scream, at least I didn't. Why can't the chaps scream? Say, oh, help me, help me. Yeah, all right.
But especially with the pregnancy, what's great, I don't know if you saw it in Day of Honor, I actually thought it was a really good cover, but maybe we didn't fool you guys. In Day of Honor, because of the pregnancy, they didn't want me to do the fight with the Klingon, you know? So we had the stunt person come in. I was at the beginning of the shot, and just as the camera moved away, I jump out, and my stunt double jumps in, does all the fighting, you know, and then it pans down to the guy, and I come right back in. Fine, you know, and I walk off. And we did it all in one shot where I would just get into her position. You know, she did all the hitting and everything. And I just thought, she did a great job. They threw on her back and all the stuff that I could not do now. But I thought that worked pretty well. It almost fooled me.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, they were supposed to be very bright people. What were they? Heaven's Gate Mod. Supposed to be very bright computer bits. But, I mean, what kind of aliens would have been following a comet around the sun for the last millennia? Why are they doing that?
Here, follow that snowball.
Why? And the other thing one would question is, like, if they're sophisticated aliens, why do you actually need to be dead to get on the ship? Just a thought. Should have had a meeting with me first about that. Bit silly. And the chocolate pudding? What was the significance of that?
Tasty.
Tasty. Something to sustain you on your journey.
I never tell lies. I never take anything. However, I did once take something during my second story. This was given to me, and the story was Robots of Death. And I had to pick up a knife and throw it at somebody, and I don't know how. But I threw this knife, and it just missed the cameraman. I mean, just missed him. And it was supposed to go into the back of a robot over the other side of the studio. So on take two, the studio emptied. Except for this one quaking cameraman going, for God's sake. Anyway, after that, they took away my sharp knife and they gave me this one, this very one. And I stole it at the end of the show.
And it was very, very interesting, the very first convention that I was able to attend. And I must say that it's also a very, it's a very nice departure from the routine, because the shooting is a routine. Make no mistake about it. It is a big routine, very much like a factory, very much the same thing every day. What you see is finished, post-production, music, everything, editing. You see it all put together nicely, 42 minutes. But it takes us 7 or 8 days to make that 42 minutes. And that is some very long hours, very early morning hours. I think I went to bed so, I got up so early the day, I got up a half an hour before I went to bed to go to work.
And I liked Earthshot because I think it was one of the strongest stories of the whole season. And poor old Matthew got blown up. Oh, shame. We used to call him Boom Boom Waterhouse. Or Matt Finish. Oh, aren't we cruel? Oh. But it was a good story, and I think if you're going to leave Doctor Who, you know, get yourself blown up. I mean, do it properly, go for it, you know. That was one of my big fears, actually, was when my time came, that they'd, you know, I'd have to fall in love with some weird-looking alien person and go hand in hand into the sunset of some planet. And I thought, oh, that's so boring. But I'm actually pleased Nyssa went out in quite a strong way as well, so. And I thought, oh, there's a possibility for me to come back, but no, nothing.
Well, you know, the doctor designed her dermoplastic garment. There were an exhaustive number of fitting sessions. It all happened off camera, but I'm a method actor, and I had to fit her over and over and over again, and, you know, things would pop here and there, and I would very meticulously sew them back on. And I'm making all this up, and I'm having such a good time, I think I'm going to do it a little longer.
I figure while I'm up here, other than the strange sound effects, do you have any fun talents that you want to share with us?
Do I have any fun talents? I have fun talents, but nothing I want to share with you. No offense, you're a very likable fella. But, no, I don't know. I don't really have too many. I make a living pretending I'm an alien. I mean, that's a hell of a way to make a living, isn't it? God, he's a Talaxian, yes. It's kind of a cross between a cab driver and a taxidermist.
So that's why Wendy left at the same time, and we all left together.
And I still say to this day, if we hadn't been mithered by these people, we'd still be there. You know, the other doctor would never have been all those regenerations. We would have just hung in there for life because we were having such fun doing that show. It was a ball. We'd rehearse Monday to Friday. You'd go to the studio on a Saturday and record it. And it was just when the red light went on, it was serious. You had to make fun of it during the week, because if you tried to do it very, very seriously on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, by Friday, you know, you're getting the giggles. And Patrick and I had a little thing. We always did a read-through on the Monday. You read the script, and there was a girl there timing it. And if it was short, because we had to do 24 minutes, 30 seconds, if it was short, the writers would write more dialogue. So Patrick and I would say to everybody, read slowly. Read slowly. If you read too quick, they'll give us more work to do. So we used to, oh, doctor, look at that. Yes, Jamie, I know. You know, and we'd do it, we'd read really slowly. And anyone reading fast, like little padders, wedding padders, oh, look, doctor, boom, shh. Oh, look, doctor, I've suddenly realized I am being chased by a great big hairy monster. That's slow, keep it slow.
When I went to audition for the doctor, did they already know what the personality was going to be, or did I work it out for myself? Well, this is one little thing I pride myself on. I think I'm the only Doctor who did not audition. I was invited to play the part. And look what happened afterwards.
Yes, little girl. Do I like being an actress? Oh, honey, I love being an actress. It's way better than working.
How you doing?
Mr. Biggs, yeah, could you get back to the stage, please? Could you get back to the stage, please?
Hey, let me tell you, my wife and I were in bed one night.
Round of applause, everybody.
Not that story.
I told him that story about, remember the time that you and I were in bed that one night? And, I'm sorry, all right.
Wrong number.
And let's get her up on the video phone.
She wants to know when we're going to be done. When are we going to be done?
Why?
She needs to talk to you. When are we going to be done?
Oh, I don't know. What time is it now?
7 minutes.
Jason, here, talk to my wife.
Hello.
Hello there. I'm very, very well.
Don't be embarrassed at all. Let me just say, why are you embarrassed? What are you wearing?
Are you all happy?
Well, don't
good.
Ask. Oh dear, don't ask them that.
Yeah.
Oh, what a dodgy question.
I don't think the ones at the back are very happy, actually. I'm not sure.
Well, as long as they can hear, but as long as we're getting over to
hello.
Them, that's all right. Hello. You haven't been forgotten.
They are yet. There, isn't it wonderful? It's like when you go to Rome. Anyone been to Rome? Well, anyone been to, done a pilgrimage or anything, been into the Basilica? Yeah, well, of course, you get thousands of people going in for a public audience of the Pope. You get sort of hundreds of people from, where are we?
We're in Springfield, Massachusetts.
Springfield, Massachusetts. You make it a party of 300 from Springfield and a football club from somewhere else and some people from Italy and everything. And the Pope's sort of right-hand man says, announces.
I think he thinks where the Pope has gone down his knees. Look.
Yeah. Bless you, my son. And
and there was this one interviewer that spoke to me and he said, so what's it like having an action figure of yourself? And I said, well, isn't it every little girl's dream to sit in a room and play with herself? Oh, no, no, no. Well, not like that, not like that. Like this, and he goes, oh, don't worry, we won't put it in there. And the headline is, Gigi Edgley comments on how it is every little girl's dream to play with herself. Dad's reading it. Mm-hmm.
Speaking for myself, as a child, was absolutely Doctor Who and Blake Seven, because I was just of that. I was just of that age. So I was really sort of came into Doctor Who at the end of Pertwee, U.N.I.T. and these guys, and then into Baker, and then on through that, and I sort of followed it right up through to Colin Baker, really, and then I sort of stopped watching it. But that's it. And then films. I was a Star Wars kid, as well. I love the first three Star Wars films. I thought they were so cool. And fantasy-wise, it was Dark Crystal, Labyrinth, anything really to do with Henson's, which was great. So that's why it was such an honor to come and actually work for the Jim Henson Company and see all these amazing teams.
Yeah. I remember, does anyone remember a show called The Prisoner? That was one of my favorite shows. And, sorry? Yeah, yeah, it was fantastic.
Yes.
Oh, thank you, darling. This is my wife, Benita Friederisi. Stand up, take a bow, come on. Stand up, take a bow, come on. Come on, come on. Yeah, I told Bonnie, I said, Bonnie, you know, I most of them have heard all my material, so if you think I'm dying, start heckling. So I guess I'm dying. Yeah. Kate's Addiction was the one exception I made to that rule about not doing softcore porn. It was the script I was referencing that it was like 17 pages of a lesbian love scene and then I come on. I was playing an FBI agent. I wasn't delivering a sandwich, but yes, I regret doing that.
And you can meet John Pertwee. I thought, well, they're being very thorough. Because, you know, that doesn't usually happen. So I said I would be delighted, and we pootled off in the car, went to North Acton, and the actor that was in my radio, Stephen...
Thorne.
Stephen Thorne, thank you. He was brought in to play the monster, and the only reason Sarah Jane knew it was the monster was because he had a snake tongue, so this strange actor was shaking his tongue at me while I was playing Sarah Jane, and I first met Stephen Thorne, who was later in the radio series with me. And we finished that, and Barry said, yes, we really like that. Now, John would really like to meet you, and I thought, I bet he would. He doesn't know me from Adam, So John Pertwee was rehearsing upstairs. He came down, and the rehearsal room's at North Acton. It is a room about half the size of this, and they're covered. It's windows all the way around. It was a very sunny day. The sun was shining through. The double doors, John Pertwee walks through. He's 6 foot what? He's got white hair, and at the time he was wearing a denim jacket, and he had this phase of going through it. He had badges all over him. He had a girl on either arm, and he walked through, and he was like, da-da! And the sun shone on him. I was quite overwhelmed, really.
Excellent. Welcome, Earthlings. I see there are enough of you here to produce new genetic material for my Daleks.
See, now, Terrell, if you had told the story, it would have been so much better. Thanks.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
No, I meant for me. No.
Okay,
I
feel a spank coming on.
No.
You're not married, are you?
No.
I feel a spank coming on.
I meant if she told it instead of me telling it, not you.
I think you need a spank. Would you like to come here? Come on, get up here.
Up you get.
Get your pet cutie over here.
Come on. Now, I'm too old to let this one go past me. I have to give him a spank for that comment. Okay. Bend over. There you go. I know, darling, I know. Only kidding. I enjoyed it. I love spanking boys.
I agree with that, man. I agree with everything you just said.
Oh, no, I'm starting something. All day long, everyone will be being cheeky with me because they want to spank. You want to spank too?
Where does they?
Because, I got a laptop because my PC was playing up, and the laptop's gone weird now. God, I don't know. God damn it. I just want to, when you can talk to the computer and it answers back in Majel's voice, then I'll be happy, you know? So, and then I pose naked with a Dalek. So, was I typecast? No, darling.
can I add a sort of addendum to this as well?
Yes.
Because in 1980, I think it was either three, I think it was 1982 or 83, I went to Australia on a book signing tour for Doctor Who. I forget which city we were in, but But I was suddenly, they said, oh, you must come to the theater tonight because Martin Shaw and Katie Manning are doing this play. So I said, oh, it'd be great, yeah, it'd be great. So I went to this play, and then halfway through, Katie Manning, you suddenly took your clothes off. This is in the middle of rural Australia.
I know, but of course
there's
everybody...
a general theme here. Anyway, going back to I believe the Daleks were very happy about it.
Yes, it was one of those bizarre plays where I just sort of walked around with no top on, completely ignoring the fact. But mind you, everybody was watching Martin Shaw. You know, people...
I wasn't.
The Puff and Ruffle, as Amanda Tapping could far better explain to you, is apparently how the male actors behave whenever there's an attractive female guest star actor on the set of Stargate. So what it is, essentially, is the perception from Amanda's point of view of how the men behave, which is, woman enters set, morning, and the men go from this mode to... Enjoying yourself? Can I get you anything water? Do you need a chair or anything like that? No? Okay. Good.
Ben, I've told the one that's like boring, but I've told the one of redecorating the set. When he was, you know, he gets captured and he's turning into a Borg in Descent, and I take over, of course, as captain. And I mean, you know, what does any woman do is redecorate the ship. And so... So I knew he was coming back, and the set designers got in with me, and we had leopard skins all over, and I got some extras to kind of be, you know, kind of naked. I'm not naked, but I mean, you know, nothing on top. What do we call that? Bare-chested. Thank you. And then I had pictures of my son all over, you know, and I had my hair in curlers. And I was there, and he walked on the set, and it was like 7 in the morning, you know, and he went, what? And I said, darling, I thought you were dead.
As I said, I'm not in this scene, so I'm behind the camera, and I'm watching. And the director says, right, okay, we'll have a rehearsal. So Pat proceeds to go along, then Frazer behind him, then my father. They're saying, now, where's Victoria? She must have passed this way. And they're all getting very worried. Oh, I don't know. And all of a sudden, Pat stops and says, ah, look, bends down and picks up a hanky. And he says, oh, it's Victoria's. She must be here somewhere. Right, come on, chaps, let's find her. So we get to the real take, don't we? And the director says, action. And that's fine. And they proceed to walk through the underground, going, oh, where's Victoria? We're so worried about her. We must find her, et cetera, et cetera. And all of a sudden, Pat went, oh, look, and bends down and proceeds to pick up a pair of knickers. Whereupon Pat says, ah, yes, yes, these are Victoria's. She must have gone this way. And Frazer says, oh, yes, I certainly recognize those, Doctor. Yes, I recognize them. And Father takes them and says, how do you know? We've outlived our usefulness.
Yeah.
You were there. So old and so inflexible that we've outlived our usefulness. I guess that was a lie. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Well, just imagine that Bill and I had been doing those characters for so many years. And for me, when I found myself, when we were playing the scene, and I found myself saying those words to him, it dawned on me that I could be speaking as Spock to Kirk. I could also be speaking as Leonard to Bill. Is it possible that we outlive our usefulness? Because I really felt that was just going to be the last Star Trek movie that we were going to make together. And I suddenly realized that I and the character had, in that moment, were totally merged. Totally merged. And that's what led to the writing of I Am Spock. That's it. I mean, that's the moment right there that said to me, There's no difference between us on this issue. And I sat down and went to work on the book.
I'll die on this stage. No, I
the dream of every actor.
Hopefully there won't be an additional charge.
Oh, just wait. It will be a great death. Spectacular. It will last forever, and it will include a really effective monologue.
No, I learned it for the show. Actually, during the shooting of the pilot, our stunt coordinator, James Bamford, came into my trailer, and he had these two sticks with him, and he started twirling them around in this crazy, crazy fashion. And he said, okay, now you're going to learn how to do that. And I didn't think I'd ever know how, but he gave me this pattern, and I just practiced it and practiced it and practiced it. And now we're able to, you know, incorporate a bunch of different kinds of patterns and add knife and whatever other options. But yeah, no, I learned it for the show. So, thank you. Thank you.
There's another person over there with his hand up.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12.
Yes, if it had been 13, I wouldn't have let you ask me a question. Okay. I have a problem with numbers. No, I don't really. I'm just making it up.
All right.
So you want to say something?
Yes, I do. it says here in the this thing here. Yeah.
The program. The menu.
The program. You lived in Scotland. Now I was wondering, from your point of view, the Europe.
Don't be nervous.
I'm not trying to be nervous.
You're not trying to be Europe either.
Yeah, right. But anyway,
why not? Europe's a great place. It's nice to be nice.
Right. I was just wondering, in your opinion, is it a beautiful? Do you like it up there? I mean, do you?
What, Scotland? Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Hello, is anyone down here?
Help me, please.
It's so dark, I can barely see you. Who are you?
Just call me Fred. Tell me, what year is it?
What year is it?
Oh, old Salty's had me down here for a long time.
Why?
We had an argument. I'm his wife.
He's married? Why would you marry Salty?
Well, it was a long time ago. He was a sailor and smelt of Old Spice. And I love a man in uniform.
That can't possibly be good enough reason to marry Salty.
Oh, all right, I was drunk, there was a full eclipse, and he was wearing a very tight uniform.
Ew, I just can't believe you. You're as sick as Salty. I'm out of here.
Oh, don't leave me, the head drains down here.
I think it is a creature even more insidious, even more twisted and depraved than the Master. It's Ginny Anderson.
Quite correct, my dear Doctor. You're always a clever one at the Academy.
But why do you want possession of this monstrous doomsday weapon?
Basic jealousy, really. You see, even when I was producer of Space 1999, Doctor Who still got the ratings, and on such a minuscule budget too. It really burned my bottom. And then when Planet of Evil got even higher ratings, well, then I knew I had to do something about it. Even my son prefers Doctor Who over any one of my own shows, the ungrateful wretch. But then, with my henchman, the evil Mr. Grade, I started putting an end to your shenanigans. First, we created the hiatus in the 80s. Then, during the Sylvester McCoy era, you'd have been reduced to a feeble shadow of your former self. And now, with this doomsday machine, I can wipe out all the memory of the show throughout time and space.
I can't! Think of all the children who wouldn't grow up watching Doctor Who!
I'm sorry, my dear, but the time has come. The fictional, constructual demonstrator, whether to do whatever it says here in the script, I've just read the bleeding thing,
just like
will dissolve him into the mist of upbeing. I just have to pull this lever. Quite bloody correct, my dear woman.
Huzzah! Break out the tiffin and honey dip scones and tea. Let's have us a party.
Licky.
Oh, there you are, darling. I hope you don't mind, but I've converted the medical bay into a botanical laboratory.
Fine.
Actually, I discovered some strange spores growing in the ship's hull, and I've decided to incubate them. Hopefully they won't germinate into weird neuromuscular vegetal creatures like what happened on Victor Foxtrot 11 expedition.
Sure, no problem. Knock yourself out.
Well, I thought knocking something up might be more entertaining, but if you say so...
No! Put down that brick!
Darling, I was only joking. This is for you.
Oh, me noggin.
Now, to insert some spores into your nose. So... so that you will understand our new masters.
What terrors await our fair sexpots as they venture deeper into the convention scene? Stay tuned after this important word from our sponsor.
Honey, have you seen my crescent wrench?
Did you look under the porch?
Yes, I did, sweetie. It wasn't there.
Well, how about in the dryer vent?
That was the first place I thought to look, sugar, and it wasn't there.
Then perhaps you should reach deep into your anus and pull it out.
Here it is! You were right. How on earth would I ever survive without you? Your memory is amazing.
Yes, folks, don't you hate it when you can't quite recall where something important is? The item is just on the tip of your brain, but you can't focus enough to see it.
Like the wrench in my ass?
Or the kids we left in Pennsylvania on our last vacation.
Exactly. We here at Perky Labs have created a special brew just for the people who are a bit absent-minded. We call it Perktastically Pneumatic Blend.
So that's how my dear wife is able to remember where I last left my wrench.
Will your new Perky Brothers coffee make my husband remember where my G-spot is?
Absolutely.
Come over here, Bob. You've got about 5 pots worth of coffee to drink.
Oh, it's hot.
Oh, be careful, Alice. Don't burn off his tongue in the process. That would defeat the purpose. Yes, Perktastically Pneumatic Blend. Just another way we at Perky Brothers say we love you.
Down by
Somebody help me. Somebody help me, yeah. I'm going nowhere. Somebody help me, yeah.
Brothers, this is what helps us get through a convention.
Oh,
caffeine.
Hot, fresh, steamy. Perky Brothers. You like anything else in your Perky Brothers? You like sugar?
Sugar.
You want sugar?
Sugar.
Would you like sugar?
Sugar.
You want sugar? I'll give you sugar.
Sugar.
You want sugar?
Sugar.
Sugar.
Oh.
There's one. Do we have any more? There's two. Okay, Perky Brothers.
Tasty.
Tasty.
Say something.
Say tasty. I am Ray Milan. This is Rosie Greer.
Let's do it. It does look pretty good.
So we called down there because Tim thought that they knew where this 4 a.m. pizza place was, you know, delivery till 4 a.m. So we called up. I called up. I go, hey, where's the 4 a.m. pizza place, you know? And the person who answers it, who's this? I said, Garrett. Garrett who? Garrett Wong. Right. Okay. And then in the background, the guy goes, it's Garrett Wong. And everyone's like, right. Yeah, they're all laughing. And then someone said, yeah, tell him to come down. We'll spank him or something like that. I was like, what? What? What is wrong with these Trek fans? Why are they talking about spanking? My goodness.
Our second nominee is going to have the most nominated person of them all. Male, female, double gender, alien life form, whatever you call yourself. Mr. Rich the Moron Kirkpatrick.
I'm on a retail!
Moron. God.
Our third nominee is none other than the infamous fanboy, Mr. Adrian Vanek. And our final nominee for prom queen is...
Queen.
No, king, I'm sorry.
It's
hard to tell. Who do you think it is?
Curtis.
You.
Curtis? Curtis? Curtis Oscar? No.
Nah.
It's none other than the man from Maine himself, Mr. James Hussiere.
All right, next up we have Anne-Marie Morin. Come on out, Anne-Marie. Can anyone guess who she is? Barbarella. In a handmade costume by Anne-Marie.
You get back home, man. Can I get one of these too?
Yeah.
It's a good one.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Anne Marie.
Thank you.
I've done the board is good, but this guy's in his robe. I love it.
People should come up with like a...
I just love it. You
know. Hello. Welcome to the Lynch Man. I'm Adrian. I'm your host. And I'd like to say hello. I've got my Dr. Pepper. Yeah, that's nice. Just sit right back. And I'll take the next call. Because I am the Lynch Man. Yes, I am.
To round off the festivities on Saturday night at United FanCon, there is the annual 10-4 dance party. This year's theme, lingerie.
Look into my eyes.
You make me feel like a king. I was a 10 feet.
So, what do you say as we go down to Inspiration Point, you and me? Watch a submarine race, eh?
A very well-dressed young man over there. Stand up, give us a twirl. Yeah. Let's have a look. Twirl round, please. That's very good. Where'd you get that? They've got some very good material there. That really is good. And it fits you better than mine would fit me these days as well. But we won't talk about that.
You don't scare
me. Cheers.
Oh, the boy. Sorry, I just have. He's been so patient. And just as a treat today, we were waiting by the elevator for him.
Yeah, I didn't have to go knock on the door.
No, we just want to show that
you poor thing.
We could be very good girls when we wanted to be.
That's no fun.
I'll do it again. It turned out just fine, but do you want me to do it again, hon?
Sure.
Just longer. Yeah, just like...
I saw you. Yes, he's been very good.
What am I missing? I'm missing Gary and Ellen.
Yeah, move that way a little bit.
Oh, excuse me. Excuse me.
Oh, stand upstage, remember, she's only got one good eye.
It's like, I'll scream, ah!
So, as I'm smaller than you, all right?
I'm throwing a marvelous party. I must say the fun will be intense. We'll all have to do what the fans of Doctor Who will be doing 100 years hence. Paul Aldred will come wearing velvet, and Debbie a very long scarf. Tim Sayward and Keith will arrive arm in arm, and Nick Tim will succumb to a rapper's black charms, and Nick Courtney will explode in British alarm. You'll never like anything more.